so we'll call the meeting to order. 7:02. I thought since we're in our first meeting, since our first meeting, I should say, with all members in attendance since the elections, that we'd go around the table and let people introduce themselves, and then we'll turn it over to Superintendent Barrett and reorganize, so.
Janine Heil, principal.
Trevor McDaniel, school committee, selecting.
Jan Flaska, newly elected to the school committee.
Mary Raymond, not newly elected.
Dave Sharp. Dave Sharp, medium tenure.
I'm Ken Cutterback, and I wanted to welcome Jan, being the newest member on the committee, and we're pleased to have you on board and glad you were willing to take a chance with us. Thank you.
Marty Barrett, superintendent for about 20 days.
But who's counting?
But who's counting?
And Patty Kavanaugh, Director of Business Services.
So I will turn.
Okay, so at this point in the year, after we've had elections, we always do reorganization. So this year, because we don't have negotiations, there aren't very many committees or spots that we're going to need. So the first position that I would like some nominations for is for chair. So I will open it up for anyone who would like to nominate a chair.
I'll nominate Ken Kodak.
Second. Do you accept?
I do not accept.
You do not accept.
I'd like to place a nomination in opposition to Ken Kodak.
Okay. And what would that nomination
be? Nominate David Sharp.
Do we have a second?
I would second that.
Okay. David, do you accept?
I'll accept that.
All right. All those in favor of having David be the chairman? Aye.
Aye.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
And I'll turn it over to the chair.
Oh, well.
So do you have your position list of...
Well, I guess we have to do some further nominations then.
Here you go.
All right.
Here's your
cheat sheet. My cheat sheet?
Yes.
Okay. Do I get to nominate? Move quickly here. So we need to fill a vice chairman position. So anybody interested in nominating somebody for vice chairman? Chairperson? Hearing none, I will jump in and return the favor and nominate Ken Kennebeck for vice chairman.
I second.
Accept that?
I would accept that, sure.
Great. Wonderful. Any nominations for secretary?
We have to vote.
Oh, all in favor of
yes.
Vice chair?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
So the rest are appointments.
Yeah, you,
appointments?
Yeah.
Okay.
For
well,
the like for the committees. For the board members.
Yeah. Secretary would still need to be.
Yeah, we'll just go ahead and do it to keep it neat and clean.
So secretary, any nominations for secretary?
I might try it because it's such an onerous position, right, Trevor?
It's very tough.
I could I'd try nominating Jan Flaska for
yes,
secretary.
I would second that.
There's really nothing involved.
You make sure the minutes are done by somebody else.
Yeah.
Now, I will caution you. You have a new superintendent who may not like taking minutes.
So. We can.
I'm teasing.
So, Jan, do you accept that honorable position? Okay. And for Frontier representative, all in favor? I think we're all in favor.
Aye.
I'm going to have to be a little tad less formal, but if that's a problem, tell me.
That's okay.
And then Frontier representative, any nominations?
It's an appointment.
Is an appointment? Mm-hmm. That one's an appointment? It's not. I would love to appoint Mary Raymond if she is willing.
I will.
Okay. Great. Mm-hmm. We are all in favor of that. And then the Union 38 representatives, are those appointments too? Or does anybody know technically?
Yes.
Appointments?
Yeah.
Okay.
We've had Ken in the past.
Yeah. Are you happy to continue, Ken?
Yes. There are three members that are voting members and two that are not.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd certainly be willing to stay on. I'd like to continue to serve on it.
Okay.
we can deal with who's chairperson next time around that group meets.
Right.
Okay. So would anybody else like to be a Union 38 representative? And Jan, for your edification, what that means is the four schools have a sort of overriding school committee, four elementary schools. And three of us get to sit on that, but only two of us get to vote on it?
Three.
Or three?
Three.
So three sit and three vote. Is there some people time? Okay.
Well, for the joint meetings, all five of you sit.
All right.
Three vote.
Only three vote. Okay, so we do need three representatives technically who are going to be voting.
The ability last run, but.
Okay.
But I don't have.
Well, that's encouraging news then. So the selectman's position is keeping you here.
Yes.
So it was great. Okay. So I'm going to appoint you.
Wonderful.
I think I'm allowed to now. Okay. I wouldn't mind continuing on that either, but if somebody is desperate to be appointed to the Union 38 voting committee, I would step aside.
I vote as Frontier, so.
You vote as Frontier anyway.
Yeah.
So.
Mary participates in that through her Frontier vote, so that.
Okay. So I'm going to stay on that, and that should take care of that. And then the collaborative.
I had sent an email wondering if it might be. It was a wonderful year serving, and I'd be happy to continue. They would actually like me to continue, so I don't mind doing that. However, I did find it really beneficial for a first year to be on the collaborative. I could always do it another year, and then Jan could do it unless we felt like he'd want to have that experience. So I'm open to do it again. I'm happy to do it again. I got a lot out of it, and I like the group.
Is that in your spare time?
Yes, the one day.
Their meetings, don't their meetings generally?
They do fall on
a Wednesday.
So,
and the odds are good that they fall either on
one of
a school committee or a
select
board
Wednesday. So I don't, it's up to the board.
Wait, you could have two people share.
Oh, you can?
You could. Better than having nobody go.
Right, and I got so much out of it, and I just thought as a new, I'm partially nominated, volunteering here, and I don't know what your schedule is like, but it's a great group, and you can learn a lot. It's helped me a lot on this board, so just an experience. But I can do it alone again too.
Any thoughts on that?
I agree to whatever's recommended. This is a learning.
I've served on it, and why don't we suggest that you give it a try as our representative, and if you find it's more than you want to bite off, then you can let us know, and I'd be happy to step back in and take back over. It is a good group. It's a good way of getting to understand really a lot more in depth, a little bit about what goes on in special education across the state, and a lot of the things that are happening in the collaborative, which really provides services statewide, and not just to Hampshire, Franklin, and Western Massachusetts. So it's an interesting organization.
Great. Okay. Great.
And I think that should do it. And I'll need that back to reflect it in the minutes in here. All right, thank you. That goes to me. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, so obviously a quick word. Thank you, Ken, for your long, steady, and lengthy leadership of this committee. And we certainly may call on you again in the future to take over if I fall on my face. or if Patty gives me too much grief. Okay, so let's move on to the minutes and review and approve them. Does anybody have any comments, corrections, edits that they want to bring up?
Make a motion to approve the minutes of Wednesday, May 4th, 2016, as written.
Okay.
Second.
Second, okay. All in favor?
I'm going to abstain.
That's fine.
Okay. 4-0. Okay, moving on to the financial statement. Okay.
Thank you, David. You have 10 warrants to sign tonight that total $115,066.47. Right now, I am projecting that we should have some money left in our budget, but we did already tap that those funds to replacing the kettle in the cafeteria. That is going to be $12,000 plus some electrical and plumbing work, which should probably round it out no more than, I think, I would say maybe $16,000 tops.
When I talked to Charlie about that too, he was hoping, you know, maybe at that time with the ovens, I don't know if that is the same work or could be fit into that, because
sure.
There's one oven more than the other, and while that's all apart, we want to kind of do a flip-flop.
We can actually, you know, Bob Lesko will be leading this, and I
right.
don't know, I'm sure we'll get in touch with Charlie, because I don't know where, because we have the roof project going on, I don't know when we're going to do this, if we're going
right.
to do it, you know, midsummer or late summer.
Right.
I think once we get the area where the cafeteria is done, re-roofed, we'll probably then look to do that.
Right.
Any other funds, I'm not projecting there to be a lot. Janine and I were talking that we would probably just do a little pre-ordering of summer custodial supplies and get them in the building, make sure that they're here,
right.
so that when the roof is done, we can just hit the ground running.
Right.
And then I have one issue to talk about with the warrants. For those who are new, we do have warrant schedules over the summer, and you'll have to come into the office to sign. But because of the how quick the roof is going to go, we're not going to have you guys sign the roof warrants. Where Ken serves on that committee, so he'll be in the review process there. But if I have to have all of you in to sign the roof, it's going to hold up the billing process, which will hold up the propay system, which will hold up the reimbursement. So we're going to sort of, because it is town money, we're going to forego the school committee signature on those warrants over the summer,
okay.
if that's okay with everyone.
Mm-hmm. Who will be signing? Would the select board sign?
Yes,
okay,
they'll be signing
fine.
The warrant. Yes, we'll be reviewing them at the construction meetings
mm-hmm.
and recommending to the select board that they should be paid. So we'll do a pre-signature, and then they'll just go on their warrant schedule.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's all I had, unless anybody has any questions.
We're just going back to the beginning. So in terms of the sort of end of the year picture,
mm-hmm.
I'm sorry to say it looks fine, but.
We're going to have some funds, but we already marked them to replace the kettle,
sure.
which is a $12,000
yep.
piece of equipment plus installation.
Yep.
And then I don't think we're going to have, like, maybe no more than, like, I'm thinking maybe 25, and that's going to take about 18. And so the other monies, we were just going to do some pre-ordering to have everything in the building delivered and everything so that we don't have to worry about that once the summer gets going.
Mm-hmm. I know we do have a couple of finance committee members here, so I thought a little further explanation. We had a projection of some surplus. We have an emergency need in the kitchen area that we agreed last month to any, if we have a surplus of funds, that we would apply that surplus towards this rather than have to go dip into some other funds elsewhere in the town. So.
Okay, any more questions, comments about financial statements? Okay, so we move into public comment. Anybody?
Well, can
no?
I interject
can,
a little
absolutely.
Bit? We have some people tonight who are representing our schools. I know there's a longer definition, who have asked to make a public statement with regards to lifting the cap on the charter schools. As you know, for a long time, I'm not a proponent of increasing the number of charter schools that we have in our area. And I have provided you with a chart that we put together as part of our rural coalition of schools. The concern of the amount of money that goes out of our district and other districts for charter school education. So because the agendas had already been done, and I know they're going to be going to each of the school committee meetings, except for Whately, because the Whately School Committee directed me, I believe back in April and March, to send a letter to our legislatures, which I did, stating that they do not support removing the cap and increasing the number of charter schools. So I'm speaking for them, but that's basically, I don't know who's speaking for you, Annette or Denise or...
Diane,
I'm sorry, yeah. Yes.
So we're here to, first of all, explain what the Save Our Public Schools Coalition is about. It is a coalition of parents, educators, students, families, and the MTA and Mass Education Justice Alliance and other groups that have come together because we consider this to be an existential threat to the future of public education. And even at the annual meeting of the MTA, it was described as such. Many people spoke to the issue. So we have come together as groups to raise money to fund a campaign, and I'm here to talk to you as a parent, a former educator. I taught 35 years in the city of Chicopee. My son went to this excellent school and to Frontier, and I can't thank his teachers enough for everything they did. He had phenomenal teachers. He got a great education in Deerfield and Frontier. So I believe wholeheartedly in what the public schools do in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, and I feel like the time is now that we have to fight to save the public schools. Over $408 million right now is going out of the public school budgets across the Commonwealth to charter schools. If the cap gets lifted, it sounds like a small number, 12 schools, but if more students leave, that's going to cost us even more money. And the way the cap law is written, that 12 goes into perpetuity. So every year you get 12 more. So you can understand, as I know Marty has explained, because I saw her on TV talking about it at length, how devastating that'll be, because already we're losing programs, staff, and just important things that we resources that we need for the public schools. So we are going around to all of the communities in Rosenberg's district that have not yet signed a resolution saying that they oppose lifting the cap. So I guess I just want to say a few more things about how bad this will be, because, as I said, much more will come out of the budget. There's no local control in the charter school system, so there isn't an elected person on it. Many of the boards of charter schools have a very corporate-like structure, and the vast majority of them don't even have a parent on the board. So it's a very different level of accountability or not. There are many things about them that are not transparent, and in fact, there have been several lawsuits in the Commonwealth to try to get records from these so-called public schools. So one of the things that I think is really important, because I was an early childhood educator and I worked in integrated preschool for the bulk of my career, is that a lot of communities have never been able to afford or are now not able to afford the other half day of kindergarten, which creates a very unlevel playing field. So those are things that we need to have in the public schools. We also take everybody, including starting at age 3 when I would take kids from early intervention programs. Charter schools are not mandated to do that. They can select the grades with which they want to take in students. They can also hire non-certified teachers who just took the test and never went to a teacher education program. And they have a lot of Teach for America kids who've taught 5 weeks teaching. So that's a great concern to me, because nothing replaces a quality veteran educator that's gone through a teacher education program, in my opinion, and has experience. So I worry about that early childhood component, because every efficacy study that's ever been published has said that you get a 7-to-1 basically bang for your buck if you get kids when they're young and give them a quality early childhood program. And that's been presented at the State House, I mean, many times when I've been there, I've heard that rap from the experts. So, and I think the bottom line here is that we need to fully fund all of our public schools. The Commonwealth of Massachusetts is a place that conceived the idea of public education. It was Horace Mann who thought of having free, accessible, quality public education because it is the great equalizer. If you have that, you can do anything. And we don't have that right now. We have separate and unequal. And, you know, I can appreciate everyone wanting to have the best for their child, but when their child having the best takes away from my child or anyone else's child in the Commonwealth, and the vast majority of kids go to public school in this Commonwealth. So I think it's a civil rights issue and a fairness issue. And also, to me, it's a bipartisan issue because every citizen should want to know where their tax dollars are being spent and why. And right now, we do not know why. And in the packets that I made for you, I put a letter that Suzanne Bump, the state auditor, wrote to the Joint Committee on Education, explaining that the data that charter schools send in is inadequate, poorly collected, poorly conceived, and there's just not enough of it to make any determination about where the funds go. So this is the person that is elected to mind the money of the state, and she's very concerned about it. So her basic point is, why would we want to lift the cap until we get this situation under control? So, and in the bigger districts like Boston, Holyoke, Springfield, they're getting hammered. They're losing 28% of their budget to charter schools in some places. So in other cities where this has been allowed to snowball, and states like Los Angeles has gone mostly charter, New Orleans, it just becomes a snowball of privatization. So I did give you all some information from this campaign in this packet. And actually, he's got one over there. So the main thing we want to try to do is just get the word out by, I'm going to have a table at the farmer's market in Greenfield, talk to neighbors and friends, because the groups that are backing this are millionaires and billionaires, the Koch brothers, the Walton Foundation, Freedom Works, and on and on and on. And we'll never beat them in the money game. But we have something they don't have. We have like-minded people that care about public schools across the Commonwealth, and we are mobilizing to fight this. And I think if we get more people talking about it and people really understand how it's affecting their public school, that we will win. I feel good about it, but I think we need to do this work. So I know most of my summer and into the fall is going to be this. So, but I'm happy to do it because, I mean, I know being a teacher what an education does for kids. So, and I'm happy to come and speak on behalf of this. And in the packet, there's a sample resolution. And so we are just going around asking if school committees would be willing to say that they favor a resolution to not lift the cap.
And there's also a list of the schools across the state who have signed.
Yes, there is a list of most of the schools. And those are actually coming in every day to MTA. So that's the most recent one. I just took off massteacher.org. So, but I had to add Waitley to that because that wasn't even on there. So there may be even more than what's there.
Do you have an extra packet for us?
I can get one. I have
two.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Okay. Thank you.
All right. Okay. Yeah. Do you know where? I thought that there was some negotiating going on.
There was.
And then that was going to avoid a ballot question. So where are we now? Are
well, there's some good, if Chris wants to speak to that. Chris.
Yeah, the way the ballot initiative process works is, yes, the committee is formed, yay or nay, that wants to propose a ballot question. It has to get X number of signatures to be presented to the legislature. Then the legislature has an opportunity to, because it's general legislation, the legislature does have an opportunity to pass a compromise bill that both the yay committee and the nay committee can agree to. Currently, the Senate has passed the RISE Act, which does not appear to be popular with either committee. There are a lot of people in favor of it, but the two committees that are pushing either side of this ballot question do not appear to be in favor of it at this time. And the House is, the House passed a cap lift bill in the previous legislative session that was very different from what the RISE Act is in the Senate. And the House hasn't really had an appetite to proceed any further with it because they've sort of said, we've already tried to do this and
nor has the governor. He would probably veto it.
The governor is an endorser of the ballot question. The yay. So at the so they have until the end of the month. I don't know the exact date. They have until the end of the month to come up with a compromise. It does not look likely that there will be a compromise, in which at which point the language as written goes to the ballot. They do have to collect another 10,000 or 12,000 signatures, but that should be pretty easy because that's a statewide requirement. They were able to get over 60,000 to get it to this point, so they should be able to get another 12. And then it goes to the ballot in November. And then it's assigned a bill, a ballot number, so you'll see the vote no on 1, 2, 3, whatever ballot number they assign it.
From what I understand from what Danny Rosenberg said is that if this ballot measure passes, the legislature never really goes back and addresses it. It's done. So if that cap lifts, then we have a major problem with funding for public school.
And I repeatedly said this, and I really am not being dramatic. I really believe it is the demise of public schools.
Yes. Mm-hmm. That's their goal.
And it won't happen overnight, but it will happen. And I'm very fearful of that. Mm-hmm. And that's why I think this group, the group that I've been working with, the Rural Coalition, you know, what is happening in the Berkshires is creeping to Mohawk. Mm-hmm. They already are down 300 or 400 students there. And it's creeping eastward. And if we have more charter schools in this area, I understand there's a difference between forming charter schools in rural areas mm-hmm. and charter schools in urban areas. I get the need that it's different. But this bill does not make any distinction
correct
between that.
There's something else is that in Brockton, the school committee, the town council, the state legislature, the state senate, the voters, the majority of voters were against a Sabbath charter school going into their town, and the mm-hmm. Department of Secondary and Elementary Education voted it in against their better wishes. And that can happen to anybody. They can, to any town. They mm-hmm. don't care about what you, if you say, well, this is the end of our school, it's going to take all our money. Well, we're going to put two in here. There's no, as of now, I don't see our state legislature or our Board of Secondary and Education protecting us against this onslaught. It seems to be more in favor of it at this point.
We are all level one and level two schools. We are highly performing schools in this area with fewer and fewer dollars.
Right. Yeah, because the money's going to them for private with public funding. Yeah. So it is, as you said, very critically reaching a critical mass.
The League of Women Voters has been studying it for quite some time, and they created a chart that they brought to our first meeting with Rosenberg a day after he said he was going to introduce legislation. And they just used Northampton as an example, and it's a very complicated flow chart, the formula for how this money, where it goes. And it showed just the disparity in the per pupil amount that was actual after all of these machinations that it goes through. And it's pretty shocking to people when they see it. They're like, what? That's not fair. You know? So that's the message I think that we have to get out. It's not that we're saying we want to get rid of all the charter schools that are here now, but lifting the cap is going to be devastating to public ed at the beginning of the end. And we none of us in this room can let that happen. Everybody's got to get off the couch and do something. That's my motto. For
So I am happy to write, depending upon how the committee feels, the same letter that I did for lately on behalf of the Deerfield School Committee. And basically, it just said that they're opposed. And you have a template in here, too. Mm-hmm. I can certainly tweak that.
And Sunderland doesn't lose any money, but I'm going to go to their meeting. We're going to Frontier. Because eventually, a lot of their kids go to Frontier. So everybody has a vested interest in this. And like you said, we're a preferred area right now, but they're going to lift that whole concept of them only going into level four areas. So all of those suburban areas that have not been touched by this, like Wellesley and Concord, are going to feel it sooner or later. And like Marty said, it may take a while, but they're coming there too. If they've figured out a way to basically hijack our tax dollars for for-profit ventures that they mislabel as a public school.
So, Marty, are you talking about a letter that you've already drafted that is very similar to this resolution?
Basically, it just says that on behalf of the Deerfield School Committee, we are writing to voice our opposition to lifting the cap of charter schools. It doesn't say that we're against charter schools, and I'd be happy to send you a draft of, or you know, a copy of what I sent for Waitley. You can take it a step further. Waitley just wanted their voices heard that as a committee. They oppose lifting the cap, and that's what they spoke specifically to.
That's a lot what the a lot how the collaborative has dealt with this. We've worked on it a lot this year, and. The collaborative has not taken a position on charter schools, but they've given us a lot of information on how detrimental it would be to our rural districts. So I have a ton of info if anybody wants it. I've tried to share some of it, but I am fully in support of the resolution or letter.
So, yeah, I mean, I fully support and applaud what you're doing. So I don't know how we want to proceed. The only thing I would take issue with, at one point you said something like, you understand parents wanting the best.
Well, that's what parents
that,
will say
to you. Just
correct
that, because it's not
you.
The best.
Yeah.
But I get it.
There's little evidence to suggest that
exactly.
They're better in
so
any way, but
different kind of
that's the argument that you will hear from people in the community.
Yeah.
And there will be a huge onslaught of money. I think it's they're proposing thinking that $18 million
yeah,
will be coming from the proponents into our state. Which is a major campaign in our state and for the proponents, and we will get hit with a lot of misinformation and lovely music and all kinds of stuff.
They threw a fancy breakfast
with great
at
names
state
like
convention.
Great Schools of Massachusetts. Oh, that sounds good, but it'll really be quite deadly, and it's all about this. It's all about getting the money. It's not really about education, not educating our students.
And the original intent of charter schools was to be these satellites of collaborative excellence where teachers had a lot more control to experiment with exciting new programs and then come back and share it. There's been no sharing taking place at all in this venture. It's a closed door.
And there's, yeah.
The only thing I want to leave the committee with, the last thing I kind of want to say, is the Deerfield School Committee, the town of Deerfield is already losing $38,000, $38,721 to charters now without raising the cap. And Frontier is losing over $500,000 to charters already without. Yeah, we're talking about a kettle needing to be replaced with $38,000. You can imagine what the school committee's budget would be going forward. And it's not our position to close any charters. It's not our position to do anything like that, just to keep the cap. The town of Greenfield has passed the resolution. Roe has passed the resolution. Those are the other, and Waitley, I guess, too. So in your decision to either vote to approve the resolution or the letter, however you want to go for it, I just want to let that be on record that we're talking about a lot of money here.
Yeah. I think we're all under the budget issues
that
are great for us.
Would you be more comfortable if I sent you a copy of what I sent on Waitley's behalf?
I'm probably comfortable with almost anything you do in this regard.
Okay.
The only thing I don't mean to be a pain, but just I agree with everything in this resolution, but I don't really have the one statement that came out that I don't really have the knowledge of that I would maybe not want the committee here, but it's when it says they often use high suspension rates to drive out students they don't want to serve. It just
That's
I'm
very
sure
true
that
in urban districts. They
happens
use the
in
demerit
places.
System.
I just, yeah, I just don't. It just struck me as a more of a.
There's a.
We're very aware of that because they come to Frontier. Yeah.
So that's how they. That's how yes. we. Okay. All right.
And then the MCAS score comes to Frontier.
Yes.
And David, just. Well, I just wanted to have some discussion about that.
Coming from Holyoke.
I want to make sure it's not just anecdotal.
No,
but
no.
But there is a.
It's actual.
When the charter school first opened in Holyoke, there was a mass outflow to the charter school. And within the first month of them being open, all our ELL kids came back, our SPED kids came back. And this went on for the first year, going, coming, going, coming. They pick and choose which students they're going to teach.
No discipline now.
And in the public school, we don't do that. We service all children.
We can't do that.
And we provide programs for them, we provide accommodations, and you know, we do the job.
And the schools are not accessible to everyone. I mean, I know the families I had in Chicopee. I take care of three kids that go to the Hilltown Charter School, and there's a taxi cab that picks up and drops off some kids. So I know that I have families that didn't even have a car whose homes I visited. So how would they ever have access to that? Because you need to have parent resources and financial resources to access the school, which makes it separate and unequal in my book. I don't think there's a person in this room that would raise their hand and say they're for the education system in the Jim Crow South. Well, that's essentially what we've created here, this separate and unequal system. So,
so we need a motion to accept the resolution?
Certainly.
Yeah, so move.
The motion to accept the resolution or letter, however, you want to do that.
The file the resolution.
File a resolution.
To basically to stamp our approval on the resolution coming from this school committee.
Correct.
Okay. I will second that.
Okay. Any discussion? The merits of that over a letter? No? All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Thank you.
Very much. Thank you for your energy and organization and passion on that one.
Are you coming to Conway tomorrow?
Yes.
The meeting's at 5:30.
I know.
Okay, I just.
And I may not be there right when it starts, but I will be there.
Okay, it will be a relatively, I will say it's a relatively short meeting, not to sabotage your meeting here, but it's a relatively short meeting because we have to segue right into graduation right after the meeting. So if you could just have a prepared statement, you may not have this amount of time for
fine.
Back and forth. Okay. Thank you again.
And I can get more materials, Marty. I have a box load of stuff.
If you could just have a couple for our
And they have a website now that's on the bumper sticker that I gave you. They have a Facebook page, and if you go to massteacher.org, there's a part which anyone can click on that says Issues in Action, and you can click on charter schools, and you can get a whole litany of information from that, including a map of the Commonwealth and the money flowing out and what schools have passed resolutions and all of that stuff.
And if anybody who wants to work on the campaign this summer, you can get Diane's name from your central office. Happy to work with you.
And I did put pledge cards in your packet, so there'll be a variety of things people will be able to do over the next several months.
Thank you.
Super. Thank you. Any other public comment on any other topic of anyone's choosing? No? Okay. Move along to discussion items, unfinished business, the famous roof update.
The roof update. The roof is going to be constructed. The roof is construction will start June 20th. There is a lot of initial testing that's occurring, some this week. I think they're going to start moving equipment. Our last day of school is the 14th. They're going to start moving some equipment on the perimeter after that. But they know that teachers essentially have that last week, even after school has ended, to remove their things. So they know no construction can start until the 20th. We do have a clerk of the works. Janine has graciously agreed to allow him to use the teacher's room, because there'll be general proximity to the construction going on. He will be here every day for the entire length of the construction that goes on that day. He will not leave the premises. So It has been an enlightening experience, and all the summer programs are slated for Sunderland and Waitley and Frontier. So I think we're in good shape. I know the teachers here have been frantically trying to prepare their classrooms and moving things from shelves, and so it's a lot to ask, and I want to say thank you, because I know you have a lot of other end of the year things, and this is an added stressor, but you'll have a beautiful new roof come September.
Okay, great. End of year funds, did we cover that?
Yes.
Yeah.
We did?
We did.
Okay. Non-union salary recommendation.
I brought this to you, as you recall, by the recommendation of a school committee member 2 years ago, a year ago, asked to have these given to you a month in advance. So they were handed out during our May meeting, and I asked if anyone had any questions about them to give me a call or an email, and I hadn't heard from anyone. And basically I had said these are the non-union salary recommendations that recommended a 2% for everybody, except for our director of IT. I had increased his salary because I believe that the reason we have as stable of an infrastructure and running technology and advancements and the ability to have an entire newly installed information system that's going to happen this summer is directly attributable to him, and not to minimize other people on the administrative team. But I think he is absolutely crucial and touches every aspect of every school in this district. So tonight I'm asking for approval of the salaries.
Patty, they were all built into the budget that
yes.
we approved?
Yes.
Okay. Anybody have any questions, discussion about those? Motion to approve non-union salary recommendations?
We would make a motion to approve the non-union salary recommendations as presented.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. New business. Discussion and vote on policy sections K and L.
I am so excited to present these to you. These are our last two sections, and I have told other school committees, and I don't think people believe me, I really enjoyed redoing this policy book, and I have brought sections L and K for anyone's reading pleasure. Mary graciously served on the committee. This will complete the entire revision of the entire policy book, and as soon as every school committee has voted and approved this, they go online, you can search by topic. You're gonna have the best time searching policy. I really like policy.
Thank you for your gift.
Marty, I think if you truly enjoy reading policies and reviewing them that much, maybe it is time for revision.
Well, I enjoyed it so much that the people who helped oversee this have offered me a part-time job to go off and I really have, I have enjoyed it. And I know that nobody else wants to read these, but I brought them in case you did. So.
I didn't print out
one of my copies. What's that?
I didn't print it out, but I'm saving these, but I did, because there's a lot there. I assume it'll all be online. And search
but
now, which
these
is great.
Are really important, because these are sort of the Bible of the district, is how we govern ourselves, and it's a reflection
absolutely.
Of our beliefs
yeah.
and the law.
Yeah.
So I know people poo-poo policies, but it really is an important thing. And to have them all up to date at once. It's very good.
I want to thank you all for your work on that.
Well, thank you, and thank Mary.
And I don't think they fit in a binder that size, do they? At least when I first started.
Not now, but now they're in a little thing like this. You would not believe how I condensed them.
Mm-hmm. But when I first started,
no, it's
a couple years ago, we think we had two binders.
Mm-hmm.
to 4-inch binders is policy.
Who needs paper when you can look it up online?
But that's the beauty of it. Parents can look at it online, teachers, administrators, anyone.
Great. So just out of curiosity, how would the process work to change a policy then?
Well, it works the same way as it always has. So let's say the state comes down with a new law. It will also come through MASC, so they will send the updated legal reference. And the superintendent will get that legal reference in the updated language and bring it forth to every school committee and vote again. So that the process doesn't change. It's just that they will automatically update it online for us. So, and sometimes it's just an amendment. You know how the bullying law changed and you just get some amendment language? Very simple, easy as pie to take care of that. So, but now you have consistent district policies. Before, you had a policy, a Deerfield bullying policy, and a weight lead, and it was ridiculous. There were 5 policies out there, so it makes sense now, and they're all legal.
Great.
So,
thank you.
Okay. So, well, any discussion about that, or if not, move along with a motion. Someone wants to make it?
I think Mary should.
I think Mary should make the motion.
Move to approve sections K and L of the policy manual.
Second.
Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And now discussion for the cafeteria.
Okay, so I put at your places the year-to-date financial statement for the cafeteria. And there's also some statistics that I added to that, too, about participation. And I am happy to report that as of May, we are in the positive $2,874. With how many more days to go, Jenny?
I don't know.
3.5. Let me ask the teacher. 3 days, because no lunch on the third day.
I'm sorry.
There's going to be some extras on there, Ken, because I brought enough for everybody.
Yes, here's
I can share.
Okay.
We got it.
At the end of last year, we lost about $4,000. So the fact that that Charlie has been able to turn that around, we cut 3 hours of service out of the budget per day, and he's also done a tremendous job with his food costs. I'm amazed at how he's turned this program around in 1 year. What does concern me is that we still have low participation. So even though we've turned the metrics that we could turn around, we're still not getting the participation that we wish that we could. And one of the things that Charlie and Janine and I are going to explore over the summer is the possibility of adding a breakfast program. But Charlie's menus have been very creative. They've been very inclusive. He worked with the PTO about having gluten-free options. So the food has gotten, the quality of the food has been better. So we just don't know why the kids aren't participating.
We thought of some kind of a doodle poll or whatever that's called to everybody.
A doodle poll?
A survey monkey. Just sort of all the parents to see, I don't know, someone can come up with some questions.
We are up.
Specifically to the question of to the people who aren't participating, what would make you, why aren't you?
Right. I think that's something that we need to discuss, because I think that is the last factor that we have not explored. I think Charlie's done a yeoman's effort cutting costs and still producing quality lunches.
Yeah.
So we've done everything we can.
Yeah. No, exactly. That's why I'm...
So that is the missing piece, and I think that's really integral to do, David, before we start this breakfast program, because there's no sense putting money in if parents aren't interested or if we cannot work out the logistics of having a breakfast program with our staff.
One of the issues I think in my own family is that there's not a lot of time for lunch, and I don't know if some kids are... or families hear about that and are put off by waiting in a line as opposed to just going to their table with their lunch.
Truly is.
But yeah, so I mean, I'm just thinking of, it may not just be, it may not be that typical food out of the library. I hear the food is bad, and maybe it's the logistical stuff too. But anyway, just it'd be great to do it.
So the downside, so that was the good news. The bad news is that with 3.5 days to go, we have over $1,700 outstanding in student balances for lunch. About 500 of that 1,700 belong to sixth graders. So that's concerning because they will not be returning.
Hold a diploma.
That's against the law.
Stamp it, subject to.
So I'm just making a plea to the parents to please send your money in, because of the $1,700, there's only 7 balances over $50. Everyone else is $2.60, $3.50. But and I know it is burdensome to write a check for that amount. But if we could just clear these up for the end of the year, it'll save getting a letter from me over the summer.
So on that note then, is that, just in terms of your accounting, is that $1,700 that we don't have within the $2,800 profit?
Yes, because we count,
so this is accrual,
we count
not
the
cash.
Sales, right.
Right, okay.
We count the sales, not the cash.
Right. Mm-hmm.
So I could, we're still gonna need, if whatever that balance is left after we do a yeoman's job of trying to collect over the next couple of days, if there's still $1,200, we have to find $1,200 in our budget and pay the and put that cash into the school lunch fund. We can't leave it in the negative.
But it's not as a negative, is it? It's you got $2,874 and you're owed
$1,700. But we're still owed $1,200 and the law does not allow us. So the $2,800 would be in there. You know what I'm saying? But
right. There's
$1,700 in cash that's not in the fund, and it needs
right. To
be in there.
No, I get that. Okay. But we're still in the positive cash flow
right. Because
you got 20 in it. You're just saying that some law that says that we have to pay
yes. The
bad debt of people
yes. Who
aren't paying?
That's correct.
Does that mean that after a certain date we can't collect?
What happens is if we get to the end of the year, and we usually go into like the first week of July, we're still making June deposits in July. If there's $1,200, then I'm going to have to write a purchase order for $1,200 from our budget to the school lunch fund. Then if we collect on that $1,200, that money goes back to the town because that is the town's money. And it's a collection after the end of a fiscal year. So any monies of that $1,200 that would be outstanding would go back to the town for a prior year collection.
I think the survey, to get back to that, another one of our schools, the participation rate is higher, but their balance is in the negative, found that they had, the kids were taking so long to get through the line because of where the salad bar was located, that just by logistically moving some things, it sped up the time so that they felt they had more time to eat. So it might be helpful to find out for those who aren't participating what the reason is that they're not.
And we can also in the fall do some time trials of how long it is taking the kids.
We did
to
do that.
Okay.
When we changed the lunch schedule, we did check and it was about 4 minutes for students to get through the line. What we find in the upper grades, usually fourth and up, students, it's 20 minutes lunch, 20 minute recess now. They're actually done and they're kind of sitting around. And part of the reason for the adjustment and the change was due to the fact that we were having some behavior issues because the students were finished and they were kind of sitting waiting to go to recess. So, but we did do the time trials. And then we actually changed how the lines were going through the cafeteria, through the kitchen rather.
Okay.
So, yeah, but we can certainly revisit the lunch schedule over the summer.
And it may not be for that reason at all.
Yep.
Families may choose to participate for totally other reasons, but
absolutely. It
would be helpful to know why.
Do you have a census to the percentage of students?
I don't know. I'm not sure.
Well,
you have that in here.
Is it
there?
Oh yeah, it is on the other.
Just on the stat sheet. Like, I don't seem to. Yeah. Where is my stat sheet?
No, I don't have that with me.
No, it's right here. We're at 49.66% of the average daily participation. So less than 50% of our kids
right.
are taking
it. I mean, I just did a quick calculation and came up with about 43% instead of 49%. don't know if that's, I have nothing,
it should
no
be
frame
in
of
the,
reference.
Yeah, average is in the 70s.
I guess we have people that like to prepare meals for their children.
Yep.
So, interesting.
All right, any more food items to discuss? No? Okay. So, reports. How about the collaborative? You sent us it.
I did. Yes. I sent it, I tried to send it a week before, so people have time to meet in the questions. It's been a great year, like I said, being involved with them and doing great work. Doing a lot of social justice work, doing a lot of education for teachers, a lot of workshops over the summer. It's amazing to me how much they actually mm-hmm. do and on top of, you know, for our districts and then on top mm-hmm. educating all the incarcerated kids or anyone in DYS. It's just incredible. So it's a great group, and if you have any questions, again, charter schools was a huge thing this year. What I put in the packet was that every year we evaluate the executive director, Bill Deal, and he's doing a wonderful job, and there's a lot of, you know, put a lot of artifacts into that. So, and his executive director's report is in there as well, with a lot of good things that they're doing at the Hack Academy and all over.
I have actually several things to talk about this evening. Some end of the year wrap ups. We had our annual arts festival day last Friday, and it's always a successful event and well attended. A lot of families come and join us. A little bit different this year, we had it spanning over 2 days, and we kind of like that that design. So on Thursday, there were two performances. One was in the morning by Band and Strings, and in the afternoon, we had the all-school performance where each grade went and did something special. They would go with Ms. Ryan and do something related to our theme of Hawaii. And it was just really nice to celebrate with each other, all the hard work. I have to commend Catherine Rashad and Janet Ryan for what they do, because I'm impressed each year with the creativity. Some of the banners are still hanging in the hallway. I was sad, I said to Catherine the other day, she was having some students take down some bulletin boards. It's kind of sad to see them go down, but they spend the entire year planning this event and all of the curricular connections across all disciplines. It's quite impressive. And then on Friday, we had two performances. One was by fourth grade in the morning, and one by fifth grade in the afternoon, and those students had worked with Enchanted Circle Theater, and they actually wrote and performed their own play. I don't know, Megan, if you want to share, if you have anything, I'm putting you on the spot. It's just amazing to see what these students can produce. I mean, it was inspiring.
Yeah, and it was only in six sessions,
yep.
The sixth being the actual performance. And so it was a lot of work in a very short period of time. And kids went from sort of being disorganized and unsure about speaking in front of an audience to speaking in front of an audience and having a lot of character, personality coming out, and confidence, a lot of confidence just with that short period of time.
Very dramatic class.
Yes.
And I could hear them, even in the way back, I could understand them this year, whereas last year I struggled a little bit.
But
I thought, they're all going into theater. This is
very
cool.
Yes, the actors and the actresses. And if you didn't know it, if you just sat back and watched, you would never think that the plays were written by these young students.
Right.
And it was just really impressive. So we thank our partnership with Enchanted Circle Theater. We're going to continue to do that. Yeah, absolutely. Supplies. So this has been a discussion that we've had with the PTA, and each year our teachers send out supply lists to parents and to families. And one of the things that we looked at last summer was that the average cost was about $45 per student, which we really found could be a hardship for many families, especially if you had multiple students in the school. So in working with the PTA, they have set aside $3,000 to help offset some costs for supplies for families. So they are actually going to
cover all of the writing utensils, which would include crayons, markers, colored pencils, regular pencils, dry erase markers, and that will help reduce some of the funds, some of the requests for families. So the letters that will be sent home, if there are any requests for supplies from teachers, will be either zero or a very nominal amount.
That's great.
So that's, well, I just want to thank the PTA for their support with that. Placement process, we spent 3.5 days on placement, and it's a really tricky thing because we have, and not too many other schools in the Valley really have to go through the process, but you're trying to create well-balanced classrooms, really looking at student needs. Parents offer input into the process. Teachers are really driving the process, and they literally spend hours looking at good matches with friendships, good matches with teachers, and academics and programs. So we came out of it and we're happy with where it's landed. Parents will be notified later in the summer. We'll wait to see if we have new students coming in, but it's a lot of work, and I just want to acknowledge that time and thoughtfulness that the teachers have put in. Tomorrow's recognition day, so it's we have two ceremonies. One is at 9:30 in the morning for the school, and one, the second one for parents and families, will be at 1:30 in the afternoon. So if you're able to attend, it's a really lovely event. We'd love to have you there to celebrate with our soon-to-be graduates. And then also tomorrow evening, we have kindergarten visitation night, and this is an evening where our incoming kindergartners will actually meet their classroom teachers and the support staff that they'll be working with next year. So they'll get to visit classrooms. Our new kindergarten teacher will be there. She's coming to meet her students tomorrow night. And Kim McCarthy and I, we talk about programs in early childhood, what Deerfield has to offer. Janet Sredico from Out of School Time program also talks, and our PTA will be represented there as well. So it goes from 6 to 7 o'clock. And then we put our little kindergartners on the bus, and they get a fun bus ride around the town of Deerfield. So that's always the highlight. And then finally, it's my pleasure to introduce Tina Jem as our new assistant principal / behavioral analyst. As Marty and I had shared before, we had a hiring process. There were 9 staff members who were on the committee. And Tina, I have some language in here just to give you a little bit of her background. She's worked as our inclusion specialist this past year, serving students with special needs and behavioral challenges. She's a graduate of Bay Path College, holds a bachelor's in psychology and a master's in special education. And she's also a board certified behavioral analyst and a licensed applied behavioral analyst. She's been an educator for 7 years, working with students really across K-12. And she's also had roles where she has supervised staff and has coached faculty on instructional practices. And she has also been a workshop presenter in the Valley, designing and facilitating workshops for staff, parents, and professionals on evidence-based practices to build skills among students using positive reinforcement. So I think she's going to be a great addition to the administrative team and to Deerfield. So I wanted to welcome her.
Welcome.
Looking forward to my
role. Next time we'll set up there.
Careful what you wish for.
And that's all I have, unless you have any questions. I can entertain.
I was just curious, when you mentioned the new kindergarten teacher, are there other hires happening this year for teachers because of retirements and leaving for various?
Special education, new special education liaison who has been appointed, a kindergarten teacher, sixth grade teacher, and we have several IA positions.
So in terms of classrooms, you don't have to tell me if it's in flux, I'm just sort of curious, yeah. So is there a higher going on, or has somebody been hired?
We have appointed a sixth grade teacher. We have appointed the special ed liaison. I've been sending communication out to staff. And what will happen, typically I'll do a letter to parents in the summertime with all of the new staff so they can see who has been appointed.
So. Is there a new teacher coming from outside for the sixth grade, or is there?
Yes.
Yes.
All three are coming from the outside.
Correct.
Yeah.
Yep.
How is the kindergarten working out? How many kids are we going to have? Have we figured out how many kids are going to be in class? I mean, I was wondering where the enrollments were. I missed last meeting, so I didn't know if it was all discussed.
There are
45, I think. There were 46.
Were 46, 47.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's about 45 right now, solid 45 before summertime.
Okay.
So, yeah.
All right.
Okay.
I don't have a written report since it's my last meeting with this committee. I just want to say thank you for the last 3 years, and thank you to everybody for my 20 plus years in this district, and I don't know, 8, 10, 12 years in other districts. So it has been a pleasure. So thank you. And I'll look forward to watching you on TV.
Oh, sure.
Well, I guess I would just add something to that. Just, I know my tenure isn't as long, but I think, Marty, we're losing a tremendous resource in you. I heard, I think it was a graduation or somewhere, all of the positions you've held in this district, which went from teacher to two or three principals, and then
three principals,
superintendent, and I just say I'm very impressed. You're a champion of public education, which is really, really important to me. And sort of the culmination of your influence on this place, if you looked at the graduation frontier, which is seeing that happen and seeing the kids that are coming out of this district, I think we really punch above our weight in education, and I think you've been a huge part of that. So
Thank
I want
you.
To thank you, and I can't wait for you to be less diplomatic and really tell people in town how you feel about public
education. That's the theater part in me, the public side I have to put on. But this is, it's a terrific district. You know, I started here years and years ago and left, and I kept coming back because it's such a good district. So I have no doubt that it will continue on. One of the things that I'm proudest about are the people that I've hired. So you can see the ongoing continuation of supporting public education. I also, Megan's still here. Can I just say?
I was just going to say, there's some other great losses.
Huh? Still here, just barely.
No, I know, but I wanted to say, this is always makes me so happy when somebody within our ranks wants to go into administration. I used to mentor a lot of people who thought they'd want to go into administration, and they'd shadow me for a day or two, and they'd say, fail it. So Megan did her internship with Janine last year, and she was sort of part of our administrative team off and on, and it was, I was so impressed with her, and she has accepted a principalship at Northfield. So I'm very excited for her. She'll be a wonderful addition to Northfield. She'll be greatly missed here. But to the public out there, anyone wanting to go into administration, it is a very self-fulfilling job. So so I wish you luck and congratulations
you.
To you.
And I'm very excited, but I will be very sad when I leave here because it's been a great district to work in 18 years.
Wow.
And I've loved every minute of it.
Yep.
It's a great, great district. And both of my kids have gone through, or almost through.
Almost.
My youngest daughter is a senior, or will be a senior at Frontier next fall.
Oh, she misses that on the tea party.
I know.
That's too bad.
You can come back.
I thought you were going to continue that.
No, this was the 15th and final tea party, so.
Can I just say?
Yes, absolutely.
Two things. First of all, congratulations, Megan. It's great to have you moving on if you choose to do so, and glad that you've been here for as long as you have. So, last meeting, we had mentioned sending a letter to a former teacher who's turning 100. I did draft a letter. Janine and Clay, got together with a second grade class who has sent cards to the former teacher in the Deerfield schools. And I reached out and contacted the Shrewsbury Public Schools in addition, who also have prepared a letter that Mr. Decker will be able to take down to his aunt later this month for her 100th birthday, which is an amazing accomplishment. She taught for
we figure somewhere around 13 or 14 years in Deerfield and 37 years in Shrewsbury.
Wow.
So we reached out. So I did follow up on that one to know. Janine was very helpful with that. I'd also like to, and as part of that, recognize and thank Clay in absentia for his years of service to the school. He is moving on and will be missed, but I wanted it to at least be acknowledged in this meeting that Clay, Clay is leaving in addition to Megan, Marty, anyone else?
Actually, there are two other people. I think that we should mention. I know I'm probably leaving somebody out, and I apologize if there's people leaving the school that I don't know about. But another, I think, enormous loss in the school is Julie Webster.
Julie Webster.
Mm-hmm. I don't know how long Julie has taught here, but I know she taught three of my kids, and she just seemed to be such a perfect fit for that sort of sixth grade transitional year when you try to make these kids sort of more independent before they go to the high school. And I know she really challenged, you know, my kids so much so she had one of them convinced that she was a Republican because she really pushed the other side of every issue, was always challenging his thought, you know. And, so that's a huge,
I can't wait to tell her that.
I know, wow, I think it's, yeah. But that's a huge loss, but a great opportunity, of course, changes.
And then lastly,
important.
We have our school nurse.
Yep.
Who's
school
also
nurse.
Leaving, Liz Laurent, who's been here for very many
times.
Years.
Yes.
Yeah.
And that would, that's all the staff, I think, that are departing.
Well, no.
Retiring.
Yes.
Retiring.
Yes.
I have one other person who's not on the payroll, who I think should be publicly recognized, too, for her incredible contribution, which is Julie,
mm-hmm.
who Chalfont, who was our PTA president for the last, I'm not sure how many years, but she really, she's one of the most organized people
mm-hmm.
that you'll ever meet, and she really turned our PTA from something that, you know, it was fine, but into a much more inclusive organization. Her organizational skills have made the communication between sort of school and what's going on just so much better. People really depend on it. We've had a lot of innovative fundraising by the PTA under her leadership with the local catalog, I know, was started, the road race that just netted over $2,000, which is a really great, fun event. I hear that the meetings, I probably should have attended some, I didn't, but are fun. There's sort of raffles, mm-hmm. there's always an educational component, and so those are really big shoes. Bill too. Mm-hmm. But,
and she really
she
was
really
the person to help bring that playground.
In the playground, yeah. Sorry, in the playground.
She was,
too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And who's taking over? Is it?
Kind of a dual April. Role, April Stroud
okay.
and Megan Donovan.
Okay. Oh, good.
Yep.
So
this is it for the summer, right?
Mm-hmm.
So,
this
yeah.
is it.
So
the occasional call to sign a warrant.
To sign a warrant. Well, great. I hope everyone has a wonderful summer.
You too, David.
And thank you all. And
thank
I guess
you.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
At 8:15?
Great.